Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of On the Mark TV and Radio here at Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. We're broadcasting today from Westfield Technical Academy. The day we're taping is a snow day, so we are here with Joe Douglas, who teaches broadcasting. Here at Westfield Technical Academy, and two of his students, Lindsay and Devante. So first of all, Joe has come here from a award-winning career in television and West Coast and in Florida, but Lindsay and Devante are students at Westfield Technical Academy, so I'm hoping we can start today's program if you'd like to tell us a little bit about yourself. And we'll start with Lindsay. Tell us what year you're in school, where you're from, and all of that good stuff. Lindsay, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you. Hang on, I just need to fix something real quick. I'll be right with you.
Okay, so while you're doing that, Lindsay, Devante, how are you?
I am fine. How are you?
I'm good. You were on our last program that we did from Westfield Tech Academy. So I know that you're a senior at Westfield Technical Academy. Boy, graduation's just a couple of months down the road. Do you have any plans for after you graduate at this point?
I have a couple of plans. I'm either going to take a month off, think about everything, and then go look for a job, or I'm going to find a job or two, see what's out there. Not anything in particular, but I'm just kind of seeing where life is going to take me, you know?
Yeah, if somebody were to come to you and say, Devante, your dream is going to come true, what's your dream job that you'd like to find?
I don't really necessarily have a dream job, but if you mean like a dream goal, my goal is maybe, you know, invest in some stocks or, you know, kind of get middle class so, you know, don't have to worry about too much. Get in the rat race and get out the rat race, you know?
Yeah, you don't want to work in the rat race too much. You want to make sure that you make enough in the rat race so that you can enjoy yourself. Lindsay, are you back?
Yeah, I'm good. My mom just had it set as her background, and I was trying to get it off.
Oh, okay.
I'm using my mom's Chromebook for this.
Oh, all right. So, Lindsay, tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, what year you are in school.
Well, I'm a freshman at Westfield Technical Academy, and the trade I go there for is graphics and communications, and I'm honestly loving it.
Oh, that's good. And is Joe your teacher?
Yes, he is.
And what about you, Devante? Is Joe Douglas your teacher?
Not necessarily, but I've worked with him a lot last year when he came in for the first time. We did some video and editing stuff last year.
Yeah. I mean, I think I met you one day here at Westfield Tech, and you were sitting in a classroom where he was hanging out, but I didn't see him actually teaching. But so the purpose of this program is that people say that, or young people say, whether they're in high school or college or just out of college, that they have ideas, but nobody's listening to them. So we have this large audience of people your parents and grandparents and great-grandparents age. So this kind of forum and platform gives you an opportunity to express opinions, which we hope they'll listen to, because oftentimes the up-and-coming generation can think about things and look at things with a much different perspective than your parents can or your grandparents can. So that was how I started this program. And this is the second time we've had folks from Westfield Technical Academy on. We've had folks from Western New England College, Manhattanville College, University of Hartford, and later on we'll be having people on from Westfield State University. And so, I mean, we had a guy who just graduated college and took a gap year so that he could afford to go to graduate school. And the last program we had with Westfield Technical Academy. I think you were the only one that was a senior. Everybody was an underclassman. So the idea of what was going to happen in the future was much more closer chronologically for you than it was for others. And people have majored in all kinds of things that have been on this program. Some are communication majors that hope to have a career in broadcast the way Joe and I have. Some of them are interested in doing public relations. One of them wants to be an actuary, which is sort of a form of accounting. And another wants to go into business. So we all come from different backgrounds. So I'm going to start out. Last week we had, take it back, we're taping on the 27th of January. So last week, a week ago today, we had the inauguration of a new administration, which was preceded by some of the most abrupt violence that we've ever seen at the U.S. Capitol. How has that impacted you and your thought process? Were you surprised by what happened at the Capitol? Were you worried by it or concerned by it? We'll start with you, Devante.
Well, to be honest, I was a bit concerned, yes, shocked, no. Leading up to it, beforehand, before all this happened, there was a lot of controversy on the internet. People arguing back and forth. It was all Democrats, Republicans, and people going at each other's throats, and all this rioting and stuff. And it was just, I wasn't shocked because I knew it was bound to happen with all the stuff that was going on from before.
Yeah. Do you think that there's a lesson to be learned from what happened?
Yes, a very big lesson. I think that, you know, I get our government and, you know, the president can be very important for our world, but I don't think it's worth, you know, fighting each other over. Like, we're, like, you know, fighting, possibly killing each other, when really we're supposed to be working together, you know, supposed to kind of be forming a unity, not having a controversy, because that's going to create tension and that could possibly create, like, you know, another world war or something like that.
Yeah. The divisiveness has been around for a long time. It's something that it's been around since I was a kid. And I thought, maybe naively, that things were getting better, but I guess maybe not. Same pressure. What about you?
It's kind of interesting, the whole thing, what that happened at the Capitol, because you look at one side and then you look at the other side and you don't know who to believe, to be honest. It's just a lot of confusion and a lot of deception going around, I believe. And it's hard, especially for us kids, to understand what the heck's going on when no one else knows what's going on. And it's just a lot of division in our country, really, just making people pick sides and dividing our country, which is not good at all.
I'd agree with you. There's a lot of misinformation out there. Do you, at this point in your lives, can you tell the difference between real news and fake news?
No. I mean, You got to really dig deep to get to the truth. And it's hard to find actual facts and not just opinions on subjects. In my opinion, I feel like news should be completely unbiased, but that's not what we're facing a lot of today, really. Like, a lot of news is just complete opinions, and that shouldn't be happening, really.
I'll second that. Where do you get your news from?
Honestly, I don't know where anymore. I look on my phone, I scroll through social media platforms, I see that there, and then turn on the TV, the major news networks, just all of it is just bad news. And it's really depressing for a lot of us kids just to look and see, really, honestly, no hope for our future.
Well, I hope that turns around, but there is so much fake news out there, and it's hard to find the truth. For me personally, I found the truth in listening to National Public Radio and watching PBS NewsHour. They seem to be the most unbiased news sources. Maybe I'm biased towards them, but that's where I seem to go. Joe, you were a frontline reporter. What happened at the Capitol impact you? Would it have been a story you would have wanted to cover?
Well, it's pretty scary. I mean, you saw reporters getting attacked. There's video of a bunch of video equipment, Associated Press reporters and photographers and workers were attacked, and their equipment was burned and damaged badly by a lot of these folks. There's a lot of I worked in Portland, Oregon, and I'm from there, and I worked as a reporter for about 5.5 years, and I worked in a lot of protests. I covered a lot of protests as a reporter. And you expect, when you're a reporter, you expect to run into people that may be a little, you know, not happy with you and whatever. That's part of the job. But the level of animosity that was on display at that Capitol riot insurrection was something that I think is unique to that specific situation. It may not be, I'm sure a historian might be able to, maybe be able to find something. But I think that the level of violence towards reporters and towards the police there and towards the government in general was special to that situation in a bad way. It terrifies me. I've seen co-workers of mine, former colleagues of mine, have been attacked at protests, physically have been beaten and been hurt by people on both sides. They've had former colleagues of mine that have had really scary run-ins with people who are like far right demonstrators, like Proud Boys and stuff like that. And then I've had colleagues of mine that have been actually physically attacked by Antifa demonstrators as well. But I don't necessarily want to create a false equivalency, because that's also a toxic thing to do, because you have to, the problem now is that it's so hard. It's so hard for, I want to hear more about it from the kids, but like, it must be so hard these days to figure out what's what. And when I was a kid, there was at least a better sense of, like, you read the newspaper, you had more of a respect for just general media because you didn't have social media, didn't have internet. So you didn't interact as much with media. It was more just kind of, here's the news. And so you felt a little more of a trust in it, I think, although you didn't totally, you know, you looked at different sources. But
yeah,
I think it's interesting too, is, and I want to hear from me, is kids these days, that's an old phrase, kids these days, but a lot of times kids are way more on top of what's fake news than adults. Kids are growing up in the social media realm and constantly used to people BSing them.
I would agree with that. I mean, yeah. It shocks me personally sometimes to sit and watch a Twitter feed about something. And really, anybody can speak out and say whatever they want. And to filter through all of that to get to what's real and what isn't can be challenging. One of the things that happened in the weeks leading up to the inauguration was Trump got banned from Twitter and Facebook and other social media, I believe TikTok, and the pillow guy has been banned from certain forms of social media. Do you think that people that are preaching false narratives should be banned from social media, or do you believe that's a right of free speech? Devante?
I feel like there's a certain line of what people can say. I believe the censorship of social media is a little much. I feel like they're censoring a lot of people. I mean, then again, it is private businesses, but with that logic, then they're like, okay, private businesses in real life, like actual small shops, should be able to open if you're applying that logic. But it's just a lot of people can't really voice their opinions anymore and are getting silenced. And it's hard to actually be able to voice your own opinion without like getting slammed by someone and like just totally getting shot down. And it can be hard for some people on both sides, really. And another thing is like certain sides are like, oh, I don't like this person. Like, we're being so divided in that sense. It's just, honestly, the censorship and the telling people, no, you can't post your opinion, you can't do this, is really bad. And there are some stuff that does need to be censored completely, but I think they're overstepping their boundaries just a little bit.
If you could offer a solution, if there was a way to change this? And what would be your advice to, let's say you get to meet with Zuckerberg from Facebook, what would you say to him? How would he change it?
Well, I know there's a lot of private fact checkers, and those fact checkers can be biased and say, oh, I don't agree with this opinion, so I'm going to fact check it and get rid of it. But that's not okay. We should be able to voice our own opinions, but at the same time, like, we need to control, like, violent things on media. Like, there are some bad things that do need to be censored. Like, there's some stuff that's not being censored that should be. But then there's, like, people saying, well, I'm pro this candidate, and they're literally getting blocked, and that's not right.
Yeah, I sort of agree. Javonte, what can you add to this? How would you solve the problem of the divisiveness?
Oh, I'm going to agree with Lindsay because she was right on everything she said. And I would like to add that maybe there should be a system to help out, like, some talking. A lot of people don't do talking. You should probably try to communicate, voice your opinion in a nicely manner without arguing, and, like, trying to get your differences out and see if you can get along.
I think one thing that, from my point of view, is we don't talk enough. We, you know, people don't talk one-on-one, or people don't listen to what the other person is saying. So we talk at somebody instead of talking with somebody. And I think if we all learn to talk with people, think that would change the tenor and the tone of the stuff.
Definitely. And adding on to what you said, like, people need to empathize and see the other side a lot more, because so many people are so set on their one, like, opinions that they have on their group. They're so set on those opinions that they can't even see the other side. And in order to come together, we need to see both sides of the picture in order to compromise and come up with a better society.
I would agree. What do you think right now, as Biden is in his second week of the presidency and he's developing his cabinet and getting them together, what do you think their top priority really should be? If you were going to go sit down and talk to Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, what would you tell them to concentrate on 1, 2, and 3?
Well, I think the most important thing is getting things back to normal. We need to get our society back to normal. We need to reopen the economy, and we need to get things back to normal, because the amount of people who have lost their jobs over this thing, and the amount of people who are literally just suffering because they can't make any money. Granted, the stimulus bills are helping, but, like, how are they going to pay for that? So much money in debt. But we need to get our world, our country back running. This is almost gone on for what, a year now, and we need to really step up the game.
I would agree.
Number one.
I would agree. What about you, Javonte?
From 1, 2, 3, I think, like Lindsay was saying, I'd sit down with Joe Biden and be like, first of all, we got to figure out this COVID situation. Figure out how we're going to help people, how we're going to get vaccines out to people, and how we're going to keep people safe. I would think some states are opening back up. I would say not yet. It's too soon. Cases are going up every day. We need to close down. Everyone's not going to like it, but I say we need at least a month, you know, just chill out, nothing open. See if cases go down, try to figure out a solution. Second, I would say we need to figure out the situation with everyone being diverse. We need to figure out how we're going to get this group to settle down and this group to settle down, and how they're going to speak their differences. And third would be figuring out stuff for the environment. As we know, global warming could be an issue and stuff. So figure out how we can maybe stop pollution or gas emissions, stuff like that, stuff that's actually going to benefit, that's going to save our world from not exploding or, you know, rotting or something.
Yeah, the previous, the Trump administration was always saying America first and kind of broke ties with talks about climate and other things. Do you think Biden has said he will go back to the Paris Accords and things like that? Do you think that we as Americans should be working with other countries, and or should we be solving our climate problem here first?
I would have to say that I think we should for a while see if we could figure it out on our own. And then maybe if we can't figure out everything, maybe we branch off and ask for help. Sometimes, like they say, two minds is better than one. So if we can't figure out the problem as a whole country, maybe we should leech off into another country and see if they can help us also with our problem. And then together, hopefully that could solve everyone's problem and we come to a safer climate and environment.
That makes sense. Yeah. Let's backtrack a second to COVID. I mean, COVID is, the vaccines are there. They need to get out to the people. And once the people can function in groups without infecting someone else, stores can reopen, retail, theaters, restaurants, and all of that. Have either of you two been impacted? Anybody in your family been impacted personally by COVID? Grandparents?
I mean, it's personally sucked. I've been fortunate enough where none of my family has really suffered from COVID. I know my cousins had it, but they made a quick recovery in it. But I know it's been hard for lots of people. And of course, everyone's getting their events and plans canceled. I know, actually, the week COVID happened, I was supposed to be doing a play for my middle school. But of course, that got canceled. And just all of these things that people were really, really looking forward to that would bring them happiness and joy just got canceled and put on hold. And that's taking a toll on people in so many different ways.
I would agree. I think it's very difficult to be socially distanced from people that your friends or, be able to go sit and eat in a restaurant. You really can't do that. And it's taken its toll along the way. But what about you, Javon? Anybody in your family, close or distant, been impacted by the disease itself?
I know a few of my cousins, like Lindsay was saying, a few of my cousins had it, but like no one really major really had the COVID. And like going back to what she was saying about the events, it's like, I agree. I could see where it went wrong. It impacted me too, because, you know, being a senior this year, I was supposed to have prom, senior trip. I was supposed to go to prom last year too, but none of it got to happen because COVID canceled everything. So now senior trip is canceled. Everything's canceled. I don't even know if I'm going to be able to graduate on stage. Like, a lot of things got canceled because of COVID. So
write some passages that are important that you won't get a chance to actually have. There were a lot of people that just say, no, we won't wear masks. It's our right not to. Do you feel that a mandate should be placed out there for people to wear masks?
Yes. Okay, now, I understand if you're in your car or in your house with the same people. It's understandable, but, like, I think if you're anywhere else, you know, walking your stuff, you should wear a mask, because even though you have a freedom, what they say, if they don't feel like they should, or it's not patriotic or whatever they say, it's just to protect others, just take your precautionaries, because cases are going up every day, and there's people out here not wearing masks, and there's people wearing the mask below their nose, and this is the exact reason why cases are going up, because people are not taking this seriously. And as long if no one takes it seriously, it's just going to keep going up and it's going to get worse as the days and years go by.
Now, are you guys in school, physically in school these days, or are you a combination of in school and remote?
Yes. So this week we're actually online doing our academics, like maths, English, all that stuff. We do that remote, but then every other week we go in and we do our trades and shops.
Okay, so working with Joe Douglas is not considered academic, but that's considered trade and shop kind of thing.
Yeah.
What are you learning about communication from working with Joe? Have you learned anything that you didn't know before about how to better communicate?
Well, we've just started. This is kind of like our first or second week. And actually, the first week, we actually had to do our trades online because we had a restriction from going into school completely. But we've learned a lot about video editing and a lot about using certain video editing softwares, how to piece together certain videos and things like that. And it's been really cool, you know, just learning the process and learning how kind of the professionals do it.
Do you think at some point you'd like to use the video as a platform to tell your story?
Yeah. I love storytelling in a way. I make videos on TikTok and YouTube and stuff. So I'd love to learn how to do that to a professional standard and maybe pursue that in a career.
That'd be interesting. Yeah. You said you did theater in middle school. You were in a play.
Yes.
So you're interested in telling a story, whether it's on stage or through video.
Yes, I love acting. I actually, I've done some of the Christmas productions at the Westfield Women's Club. I don't know if you know Kathy Palmer. She's amazing to work with. Such an amazing person. And I've just been, like, I've loved acting. I've done it since I was, like, 8. And, you know, I hope to bring that into a career opportunity for me someday.
Well, you wouldn't be the first person from Westfield to start in Westfield and make a career for yourself. There was an actress named Ann Petoniak who... she's been dead for years, but when she grew up in Westfield, and she ended up being on Broadway twice and getting Tony Award nominations. And then there's a set of brothers from Westfield, the Burridge brothers. Both of them are in Broadway shows, or were before the pandemic. So you could be, I think the talent scouts might be looking upon Westfield. You never know what kind of future you'll have, but the ability to do stage work and to tell stories with video is really an important thing to learn, and a great talent if you have it.
Yeah, and like I love kind of directing in a sense. Like I love just shooting and trying to get that perfect video footage just to make it extra and just make it so much better and just add that piece of cinematography that makes a video what special. Like what it is.
Yeah, Devante, did you take any classes in graphics or video or any of that?
Yes. Last year when Mr. Douglas first got there, we did some video for the remainder of the year, and I've learned how to cut and how to take a long video and cut it and still make the video relevant with showing less footage. I learned a lot about B-roll, a lot of stuff that we did in my Google Drive, and I do plan on using that stuff in the future because I see multiple things when I think of videos or photos than most people think. I can see like what it means to me. Everything in that video or picture can have a meaning. Like a leaf could have a meaning, the ground can have a meaning, the water could have a meaning, bridge can have a meaning, like anything. And I just like to think about the key features, like, you know, stuff like exposure, your ISO and all that other stuff, your shutter speed, all that really comes to play when you're taking a video and picture. And it's like, it's really unique to you and yourself when you're going to do that, because it's like what it means to you.
Well, you said that you're graduating and that you're thinking about a variety of different things that you're going to do in the future. Do you think that the art of storytelling will be a part of something that you do, whether you create a video or whether you become a writer or a photographer? Do you think that as you move down the road that you'll want to be telling somebody else's story or perhaps your own?
It was one of my hobbies of mine. I was actually thinking, you know, on my free time, I take photos and kind of, you know, make stories out of them or something mysterious. I also like to do really mysterious photos, black and white. I like to kind of try to make it like a suspenseful meaning. So I do really think about turning photos into something about storytelling for like a hobby or maybe a side job. Who knows?
Yeah. I mean, I think that one of our best skills as we grow up is to be able to communicate, and whether it's two different sides communicating together or whether we go into it as a career telling other people's stories. The ability to communicate is probably the most important skill set that any of us could ever have moving ahead. But that's definitely just, that's my idea. We're going to take a quick break here because we have underwriters to acknowledge. We are talking with some fabulous people from Westfield Technical Academy and their teacher, Joe Douglas. We are broadcasting from Westfield Technical Academy Studio 120. And because it's a snow day or a remote day, the halls are very quiet here. But anyway, after we acknowledge our underwriters who put us on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB, we will be back. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm Mark Hour back. Don't go away.
SKB is provided by Westfield Bank. For more than 160 years, Westfield Bank has been an important community presence and commercial leader in the Pioneer Valley. With convenient full banking services in Westfield, West Springfield, East Longmeadow, Agawam, Feeding Hills, Springfield, Southwick, as well as Enfield and Granby, Connecticut, visit us on the web at westfieldbank.org.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com.
Join us the third Wednesday of every month with Selectman Joe Deedy and his take on everything Southwick.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back, everyone. This is On the Mark. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. We broadcast every Wednesday from Westfield Technical Academy on both 89.5 FM WSKB and Westfield Community Programming Channel 15. If you've missed a part of today's program or you want to know what young people think from some of the previous programs that we've aired, all of these programs are archived on YouTube at what WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. So Devante was on in the fall. His back issue is somewhere on YouTube under the WSKB Community Radio. And What Young People Think is an ongoing segment that we do here as often as possible because you guys have some great ideas about what's happening and what's going on. So everybody, they say by the end of 2021, everybody's going to be vaccinated and things are sort of going to go back to normal. What's the first thing or the thing you've missed the most during the pandemic that you want to rush out and do? Lindsay?
My family, every year we go to Disney World for vacation. And last year we usually go during April vacation and we didn't get to go. And I really love going there. It's my favorite place to go in the whole wide world. I miss that. It's just a chance to break away from reality and just live kind of in that fantasy world. So that's the first place I'm going.
So, okay. So we need to book your tickets to Orlando as soon as the pandemic's over. Okay.
Yes.
What about you, Devante?
The thing I miss the most is just hanging out with friends, able to hang in a big group with not worrying about contracting a virus or something. I just miss hanging with the people that, you know, I hang with all the time.
Yeah. Do you miss going to the movies or going to a sporting thing or just hanging out, huh?
Well, yeah, I do miss going to the movies. I can admit that. There's been times where I went to the movies with my friends, and now I can't really do that because COVID's, like, kind of messing with everything.
Yeah. Joe Douglas, what do you miss? What is the first thing you're going to do when the pandemic's over?
Just go out to eat. To like a restaurant with my wife and like a normal night out. Like, I miss just hanging out with people, like Devante said too, just like hanging out with friends and not worrying about like getting a disease or coming home and spreading it to someone else, you know, just normal, like going out and then not sitting outside and freezing, you know, the whole time.
Yeah. Like I miss not going out to, with friends. And I was very brave up until right before Christmas, and I did go meet people for coffee outdoors and stuff. And I actually, as a theater reporter, went and saw a play outside the Thanksgiving weekend in the Berkshires. And it was probably 20 degrees out. It was at night. I was bundled up in like super layers of clothes, and they had everybody socially distanced. But my first thing is I want to go to a play or a musical in a theater and not be socially distanced and not have to wear 15 layers of clothes and then afterwards be able to go have dinner with somebody, not outside, but inside at a restaurant. That's my dream, you know. So, all that. Do you think people? Do you guys think people have changed during the pandemic? Do you think people are kinder or more aware of other people, or do you think that people have, as they've social distanced, become more self-absorbed? Lindsay.
I think everyone's changed in their own way. I know I've changed a lot, just kind of seeing the reality of the world and kind of just getting that in my head kind of made me a little more mature, I guess, kind of to face the facts of reality and see that. I think for a lot of us, really, it was kind of a time to just, okay, you're growing up right now. You got to face what's going on right here.
You think in a way that's part of your, I don't want to say childhood, but part of your youth was stolen from you, be it by the pandemic. I mean, no parties, no proms, no this nor that. Do you think that that's made it more difficult?
100%. It's been really tough. Kind of, because these are the years in your life where you can kind of just go out and have fun and be young and just have a good time. And that we got robbed of that. And I think for the past year, I've just been really mad at the world.
Yeah. What about you, Javante? I mean, you said earlier you might miss your prom. There might not be one. You don't know whether you're going to graduate, be able to actually walk and get your diploma, or whether it's going to get handed to you in the mail. Do you think that you've missed something in your life during the pandemic? And do you feel that your world has changed?
Oh, yeah, most definitely. You know, when we went into this, I was 17 and we're still in this and I'm 18. So I kind of missed the last year of being technically a minor. So it's like, you know, there's a lot of things that I could have been doing, you know. I've been going to movies, time wasted, making more friends, being social. And I think being in pandemic and quarantine, I'm pretty sure it made me just a slightly bit less social. I don't know. I know how to talk to people, but I really rather not talk to people. Usually in my room, it's made me very, very, I'm going to say lazy. It's just made me not want to do anything. It's just kind of wake up every day and you're just like, ah, it's just going to be the same, whatever. Go to sleep, repeat. So, yeah.
Yeah, I find it very restricting. I mean, I miss people contact the most. I mean, I can Zoom, you know, meet a friend on have a Zoom coffee date or whatever. But I just miss being in one place all the time other than when I go to work. And that gets old really, really quickly. Moving to other questions, healthcare. We talked about the pandemic. I would assume that a lot of people have just gone bankrupt trying to pay for their health. They were having problems paying for healthcare before. Do you think that the government needs to do more to make healthcare affordable for people? Should that be like a top priority with climate change and getting the economy jump started? Or has that not really personally impacted you?
Well, it honestly personally hasn't impacted me much because, you know, my family kind of pays for that and everything like that. But personally, I feel while healthcare shouldn't be 100% free and give me, I feel like it should be cut down a little bit. It's very expensive, but it's kind of a necessity that it does need to cost a little bit to keep the money in circulation.
Yeah. What about you, Javante? Any idea?
Well, yeah, the healthcare thing, I think maybe during times like this, there could be a little more aid, but then, you know, since it's pretty difficult at a time like this, but I think maybe after it can go back up, but right now everyone pretty much needs healthcare due to the pandemic and how Corona is affecting, you know, members or what it.
You guys are not impacted by student loans. I mean, I don't know if you're either one of you are thinking about college down the road, but a lot of people that are in high school are really concerned about the cost of continuing their education. Is that something that you're concerned about at this point? Should there be access to free college? Do you feel that you'd be willing to put yourself in debt to get a degree?
I feel like, again, there's always scholarships and things like that. I feel like college costs a lot more than it should. I feel like colleges themselves should maybe, like, you know, maybe not cost so much, because like it can be upwards to like $100,000 for college. Like that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. But I feel like the government should not really give much aid, because colleges are usually their own thing. They're private. They aren't really funded by the government. So why should the government give aid to colleges?
Yeah. I mean, some of your state schools, you know, there are private colleges, yeah, but there are also state schools and trade, yes, schools. And let's say you want to, maybe college is not the path that you want to take, but maybe you want to go, let's say, to broadcasting school, or learn, or take your, the trades that you're learning now and take it to the next level. Do you think that it should be subsidized? Devante, when you graduate, if you decide to go back to school in some level, do you expect or hope that it would be paid for?
Not necessarily. I mean, during this time, it's like the same thing with healthcare. Maybe some aid, but like at the same time, I feel like if I have some type of effort myself to go pay for, you know, I feel like I get more of a benefit out of it. When you pay for something, you kind of feel like, oh, wow, yeah, I did that. I paid for it. I managed to be able to do this. I would like some type of like benefit from it. So I would say maybe aid, but not like fully aid, something so I have something to look forward to paying. So that sense of achievement.
That makes sense. Do you guys set parameters or goals for yourself and say, for example, when I'm 18, I want to be here. When I'm 20, I want to be here. When I'm 21 or 25, I want to do this. Are you goal setters, or do you take it day by day?
Honestly, I feel like I set kind of too much of an expectation for myself, because like I want to be able to get to this achievement, but also I can sometimes push myself too much and it can be bad for my mental health. I feel like if I need to set goals for myself, but at the same time, I shouldn't be too over worried about my future.
Yeah, what about you, Devante? Are you a goal setter?
Yeah, I usually do short-term goals, but I do have a couple long-term goals, like Lindsay was kind of saying, and you were saying, I was telling myself that after I graduated, I was telling my parents too that I was thinking about 2 years of staying here. So, you know, 2 years of working, saving up money, I think 2 years would be enough to save up some money, you know, so when I'm 20, I can move out of the apartment, you know, pay for a car, pay for my insurance, and I'll still have a job by then. It's kind of, you know, start me off.
Yeah. If you guys were talking to somebody who was in the sixth or seventh grade, I guess sixth grade is, that's early middle school, and you were going to offer them advice on how to get to where you've gotten, what's the most important thing that you would tell them? We'll start with you, Devante.
I would tell them to breathe and always count to 10. Because when I was in middle school, I really had no one to sit here and tell me that reality was harsh. I would tell them that, not exactly be blunt about it, but I would tell them slowly. I'd be like, the world's not what you think it is, and I'll give them to them piece by piece, because it's stuff they're going to need to know that no one's going to tell them. And I'll break it all down to them that they just kind of need to sit down, cool down. Don't go blowing anger. Just kind of take it step by step and just ease your way into it.
Now, that makes sense. Step by step is always a good approach. What about you, Lindsay?
I'd say to kind of, in a sense, my younger self, or like people in sixth grade, that don't get discouraged when people come at you and want to tear you down, because people who want to bully you and tear you down and make fun of you, they got their own problems. They got more problems than you, because they honestly look up to you and think, that person's better than me, I want to bring them down. Because it's just, they're kind of, in a sense, kind of jealous of your accomplishments. So you shouldn't let them tearing you down tear you down, actually. Like, you shouldn't let them win.
That's well thought out. That's very good. Next question. If you have a friend whose parent or grandparent were going to chat with you, and what would you say to them about how they should be working with their children or grandchildren to make their life moving forward easier? Would you have advice for a friend's parent or grandparent? Based on your own experiences.
I feel like a lot of parents really helicopter their children. There's a limit to kind of just parenting, in my opinion, where you shouldn't be all over your kids, but you should also watch out for them at the same time. Like, you shouldn't control everything that they see, do, and watch, because that'll just lead them to them sneaking. It'll teach them bad habits and going around the, basically finding loopholes and stuff, and that's not good. So while you should monitor your children a little bit, you should like lay off a little bit, let them do their own thing at times, because they'll learn from their mistakes and they'll eventually correct themselves.
I agree. And I love the term helicoptering, because I have a relative who hovers, and they call her Miss Sikorsky, which is the name of a helicopter company that's down in Connecticut. And because she presents like a double rotor helicopter over all of her family decisions. Devante, what would you tell somebody's parents, the best advice or best practice for dealing with somebody who's a senior in high school?
I would have to agree with Lindsay, and I'd like to add on to it that the whole helicoptering thing, I wouldn't want to like spoil them and like do like everything for them. Like, I'd aid them, but like, I'd also watch out for like their behavior. Like, a lot of parents don't talk to their kid about how they're feeling or about how their day is. So they don't know what goes on in the kid's life. You know, I feel like if I was speaking to one parent, I'll tell them just to make sure to pick up on their kid once in a while, ask them how their day is, ask about their feelings, talk about it. So that child knows that, oh, okay, I'm appreciated. And, you know, it gives them that motivation to keep doing what they're going to do. And it'll give them that sense of respect, and it'll give them an outlook on how they see you.
Yeah, it's funny. It's a lesson that they should have learned. But, you know, they were all in your shoes 20 years ago or 30 years ago or something like that. They were all struggling with high school or struggling with the idea they're going to graduate, what are they going to do next? But somehow, as people grow up, they forget a little bit about what they went through, and they turn that off. Do you think there should be more mentoring, adults that take an interest in young people, so there's communication, and that your parents or grandparents should mentor other kids besides yourself so they have a better appreciation of what you're going through?
Does that make sense? I feel like whenever my parents, like whenever my friends come over, my parents will sometimes like kind of be a second parent to them and help them out with their own problems. And I honestly kind of love that. Whenever I love talking to adults personally, it's just like another type of person I'm talking to, and I love kind of getting advice from them that maybe necessarily I wouldn't have gotten from my parents, and getting another view on different perspectives and things in life.
Yeah, I'm always fascinated by other people's experiences, and it doesn't make a difference whether they're older than me or younger than me. I have two college-age students who work for my company who I love talking with. First of all, they can teach me things on my phone that nobody else can. But I've learned more about people your age from talking with people your age than I ever would have if I didn't put myself in that position. So there's a lot that can be learned from communicating with other generations and getting mentored along the way. I got a question for you, Joe. How did you get all these great students that you bring here? Are they just floating around and we don't recognize them, or are all of your students this great?
Every kid is awesome. They're all great people, and they're all human beings that have a lot going on, and they're very complicated and much more like every person in the world. You know, I think, I don't know. I mean, I think Devontae and Lindsay are both wonderful kids, very smart, very well-spoken, as we've all been seeing and listening here, and very gracious to do this and be like on a TV show, which a lot of kids is kind of scary for them, understandably. So there's all kinds of wonderful kids. And the cool thing about being a teacher with a sort of a creative realm is, and in the graphic arts, like, you know, Devontae is kind of focused on some other graphic art stuff. He does a lot of graphic design with Mrs. Grimsley, another teacher in the shop, and does print stuff with Mr. S and Mr. Siklecki, another teacher in the graphic art shop. My program is part of a shop, so it's like a program within a program. So the cool thing about the shop, in a lot of ways, is that it's a lot of stuff is great creative. So you end up seeing kids creating in my part of the shop, like videos or broadcast oriented type things, and you kind of see where they're coming from a little bit. And then you see a kid make a flyer or a brochure, or, you know, they're making a t-shirt or something else in other parts of the shop, and you kind of get a sense of who they are, and they do a good job. Mrs. Grimsley lets them kind of like really go wild with making these like memes and kind of type of things, and creative things that kids are just kind of in, like, what they're dealing with. So it's really wonderful to be able to meet all these different interesting people and see where they come from and how they work and how they perceive the world. It's often radically different than the way you perceive it. And it can obviously be challenging sometimes, but it can also be really good, I think. It's enlightening, and you're always learning. So it's
Joe, when you were out there being a reporter, did you ever anticipate that you'd be teaching?
Yeah, I did. I taught a long time ago, right after college. I was just a substitute teacher. It was like a day job. And I was like a comedian, and I was doing sketch comedy, and I sold a screenplay eventually, middle of that. I was writing scripts at night. And I'd go from teaching, substitute teaching in the afternoon, and have chalk on my hand, on my arms, and be going to like a movie studio and pitching a movie, trying to like clean myself off and go with my writing partner and like trying to sell a screenplay for a long time. And I lived in Los Angeles. So I kind of anticipated in the back of my mind, like, I'd probably go into something education oriented eventually. I didn't want to be in television forever. It's not like the greatest career if you want to have a family necessarily. But yeah, and I was like looking maybe at going into higher education or whatever, but I kind of learned more about the vocational education aspect of it from colleagues of mine in Oregon who had gone into it. And then I saw this position open here, and I was like, I thought it looked amazing. And I was so ecstatic that I even got the job. So now here I am. So I really enjoy it. It's really fascinating. And it's a completely different dynamic from journalism in many ways, or reporting and videography, which is all part of my job. But it's very people oriented, and you have to be open and listen to what people are saying. And one of the big things about reporting is you always have to be able to go wherever the facts go. You come into a story and you think, I know where this is going, or you have your assignment manager, your boss say, hey, I want you to go do this story on this thing that's going on over here. And you know, everybody usually in the newsroom has their own thought about, well, this is what it is. Okay, this is what the story is going to be. But if you're a good reporter, you're going to go dig and find, talk to all the people on different sides of the issue and find out that's not at all what's going on, or maybe it's something completely different. And that's kind of like education. You're teaching and you think, I want to do this, and this lesson is going to go this way. And it's like, no, it's not. So you just have to roll with it.
Yeah, and I think that the programs that you have here at Westfield Technical Academy and the students are just, the opportunities here are endless. The fact that you've got a full tilt television and radio studio that's broadcasting on the campus, and the culinary program puts out really good meals next door, and people are learning such incredible life skills that I certainly didn't get in high school. I mean, I went to a traditional New England boarding school. I got certainly a great academic education, and I got a lot of skill sets to take me out in the world, but I don't think I graduated high school with the ability to make a meal or to use my phone to create something. Of course, we didn't have smartphones then, or get a chance to do graphic design. So I think you guys have phenomenal opportunities. And that wraps up another hour of What Young People Think. And I want to thank Lindsay and Devante from Westfield Technical Academy for taking a part of your morning to join us, and Joe Douglas, their teacher. I hope you guys will come back again at some point. And that means that we'll have to get, Devante, we'll have to get you on before the end of May when you walk off into the world with a great future ahead of you. And Lindsay, you'll be here for a while so we can get you on next year. Thank you so much for joining us. And that wraps up another program on the mark, What Young People Think, here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. Joe Douglas, who teaches broadcasting here at Westfield Technical Academy, thanks for rounding up some good students for us. You've done this twice, and we're most appreciative. If you missed a part of today's program or you want to see some of the other segments of What Young People Think, you can find them on YouTube on Westfield WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. That wraps it up for this week. See you next Wednesday.